we are going to be talking about data and IoT land. This is going to be more kind of the data side because it's not as physical as like some of the other IoT talks I do, but it'll be fun. IoT data, it's a thing. Before I get into that, though, let me tell you a little bit about myself. Hi, I'm Jen. I'm a developer advocate at Google, which means that I somehow figured out how to convince Google to pay me to spend time coming out to conferences like this, talking to people about Google products, and also hearing all of your stories about what we could be doing better, what we do well, all that kind of stuff, so I can go back and make our products better so you can build even more awesome stuff with it. And I focus on the cloud side of Google's APIs. But like a big part of my job is successful because I hear from all of you. So if you ever, if there's anything I can ever help with, or if you ever have any comment on Google APIs or a challenge you're facing, or you need more quota to try out some product, feel free to give me a ping. You can ping me on Twitter, I'm MimmingCodes on Twitter, or if you go to mimming.com, you can find my homepage, which has other ways of contacting me. I like homepage, and I'm going to try and get that term to come back. So that's enough about me. Here's our agenda. So we're going to talk a little bit about kind of the data challenges around Internet of Things stuff, the great Internet of Things and a lot of its data challenges. It's a big complicated landscape. We're going to spend a little bit of time on one specific use case because Internet of Things is pretty broad. So I'm going to narrow it down to one specific use case I seem to be encountering a lot as people build stuff. Then I'm going to share with you a recipe that I use for dealing with data with that particular scale and that particular like profile of stuff. And then I'm going to follow it up with a demo. As part of the demo, we're going to like simulate the Internet of Things because if I actually like did high bandwidth IoT stuff in this room, the Wi-Fi would be weeping for like many yards around. We don't want to do that. We don't want to wreck the presentation next door. It would be mean. And that's going to kind of include like how to capture data with kind of a pub/sub thing. It's a preview into the recipe. Wrangle the data with Dataflow, which is one of our big kind of like ETL pipeline processing systems, and analyzing it with BigQuery. And along the way, I'm going to share like open source alternatives to kind of implement this model elsewhere. But I'm going to be using Google Cloud Platform stuff as my example because they, you know, they paid for my flight. So I talked a little bit about myself. Now I want to hear about all of you so I can kind of steer the content for the rest of the talk. So I think I have four questions in here. I always forget because I'm always changing these kinds of slides. So how many of you are, like people come to the Internet of Things from all different backgrounds and have interest in it for different reasons. So how many of you are on the hardware side of like IoT stuff? Cool. How many of you have like a web development background? A lot of cool. Any data scientists, big data junkies? Cool, okay, well then this recipe is going to have some cool stuff. How many of you are not in STEM fields at all, like other parts of the ecosystem? Cool, a couple people. Neat. Okay, thank you much for doing the hand game. So the Internet of Things. We all come to it from a different perspective with a different problem set. And when I say the word Internet of Things, a lot of us think of different things. So for some of us, like it's about like the hardware, the electronics, the stuff that interfaces with the real world. And maybe specifically about the rise of these easy-to-use electronics dev boards and this cool tool chains that have caused like this maker movement to explode, like a lot of the things in this picture that I found on Flickr. It's been pretty cool. It's kind of created a whole new market, and like Internet of Things as like a hobbyist thing has like kind of appeared out of nowhere, and it's awesome. Others of us are kind of networking geeks. Like I kind of fall into this bucket. We're the ones who will like read RFCs for fun. I've definitely caught myself doing that a few times. And we think about, like, there's this whole new class of device, and how are these things going to interact and pass data around? How are we actually going to make them move data in a way that works? And for other people, it's just like, I have a problem, I need coffee, and for some reason I need the internet to control it. And I'm building a startup around my internet-controlled coffee pot. So, you know, some of the specific problems, but no matter how we're trying to like impact people, whether it be changing their lives through internet-connected coffee or hacking on some cool project, there's one thing that kind of cuts across all of those, which is data. So a big part of the Internet of Things is just there's a lot of data moving around. And it's something we're used to. Kind of like, you know, soupy sets of data flying around. But IoT kind of exposes some new kind of problems, just kind of on the scale of that data. Because sometimes it gets super, super huge. And you know, it has a variety of shapes, But no matter what, it's usually important to our use case to kind of solve, to kind of wrangle that much data. Sometimes, in fact, it's so much that we can barely keep up with the data, barely keep up with writing it to disk, let alone actually doing anything with it, which is why a lot of situations I've ended up in, I have a whole bunch of data, I manage and record it, I know it's important, but I'm spending so much effort just getting it saved and durable that I actually don't have any time to extract value from it, which is a bummer. And at Google, we've been dealing with really big data for a long time. Like when most people hear the word Google, they think of this. It's a web page. It's very popular. A lot of people use it. But behind the scenes, you know, if you ask a Googler what they think of when they think of Google, they probably think of something more like this. This is a picture from one of our data centers. The lights were actually added for the picture. It's usually not that pretty. But that is a real data center. That one is up in Oregon. And we spent a lot of time thinking about using lots of commodity computers to keep up with lots of data flooding around. And it turns out that a lot of the challenges we face historically kind of line up with a lot of the challenges people are facing with dealing with data for the Internet of Things. In fact, like big data around like indexing the entire web and handling all the spam mail and Gmail and all that kind of stuff is some of the original problems that pushed us into cloud computing like more than 10 years ago. We just did it internally. And as a result of that, we were one of the first people to run into a lot of problems, which a lot of large companies have. I mean, this is not specific to Google. A lot of large organizations will run into problems early on, and we end up having to solve them on our own. And we're kind of geeky. We're kind of academic. We're kind of nerdy. So we share a lot of information the way a lot of academics share information. We publish research papers. And Google Research, you can actually go download these papers and read them. Some of them are pretty interesting. And we've been doing this for a long time. Like a couple pictures I have up there now are some of our early papers. One is the PageRank algorithm for how we, it was an important influence on how pages are ranked in search results. Another one was the MapReduce paper that we published many years ago, which kind of gave rise to a whole ecosystem of MapReduce processing stuff, which is cool. And we've continued to do that. So we've been publishing papers. We continue to. And like here's a few internal tools that we've used to deal with big data that have ended up getting published as research. For example, Bigtable is up there. Boop. I have a laser. Cool. So we published a paper on Bigtable, which is a really fast key value store that we use for just about everything. We have a paper on Flume that we published on how we kind of pipeline our MapReduce stuff when our MapReduce is starting to get too complicated. Dremel, which is a tool we use for dealing with logs at the scale that we encounter with, you know, like YouTube.com or Google.com. So we've continued to publish the research papers. And what's cool about them is they contain all the math that people use, that people need to implement these same ideas. And that's what we've kind of seen happen, is as we publish this research, we've seen open source go take those ideas and implement things. Like for MapReduce, we got Hadoop and a bunch of other stuff. But sometimes people will just read our papers and straight implement it. Like they'll take the diagrams we put in our research and use that as diagrams to build software, which is kind of cool. Like Bigtable gave rise to Apache HBase, which is a nice distributed key value store. Flume gave rise to Crunch. Dremel gave rise to Apache Drill. And that's awesome. But not all of the details ended up in our research papers. Like there's usually little engineering details. And we kind of like our own implementations. We think they have some snazzy, non-functional behaviors associated with them. So when cloud computing started becoming more popular in general, we took our internal implementations and we repackaged them up. We gave them, in some cases, a new name. Flume became Dataflow, Dremel became BigQuery, and Bigtable, well, that name we liked. We gave them a snazzy hexagon, put a little white icon inside, and made them commercial products so people can use them, which is cool. So we took a lot of our internal services, polished off the parts that the rougher spots, and made them banded services. So there's some background. But anyway, we were talking about coping with big data. I kind of digressed a little bit into a lot of our big data-y stuff. Let's talk a little bit more about the way we've kind of coped with data in general. So this is getting a little bit more abstract. It's not as Google specific, but I'll kind of come back to it, back to the original point soon. So we're talking about big data. So we're dealing with IoT stuff, and we have a lot of data to deal with. Sometimes we end up in situations where we had like a little Perl script that was munging through data just fine on our 500 sensors, but then as things scaled, it got bigger and bigger and bigger. And our little sensor network for our smart city or whatever has thousands of sensors burping out data several times per second. And just the throughput ends up becoming overwhelming. Such that our syncing CSV files around to Dropbox worked before, but not anymore. And Excel is getting really angry at trying to pivot that data. So we end up doing the logical thing is we build software and we start slicing the data. We start partitioning it to deal with it. So maybe we partition it by time. This is a good way to work with data, but it's really just kind of an abstraction on the top of the fact that our data is really kind of a big old fire hose going all the time. And in IoT systems, another thing we end up dealing with a lot is delayed data. Because just like the old days of the internet, when networks were not as reliable as we're used to for like web applications, a lot of like IoT systems may deliver data that was actually created a long time ago. So there might be, especially if we're using like a mesh network or something, mesh networks go down all the time. When it comes back up, that your end devices are going to go through the data that they have cached and push it up. So you end up with data coming way out of order, which is a problem we have not had to deal with as much. So we have a huge stream of unprocessed data, a huge stream of data. Data's coming out of order. And different abstractions we use all kind of have different compromises. So if we had sliced it into chunks, what we can do to churn through that data, if it's really big, is like almost every time I have a conversation with dealing with big data, we talk about different ways we deal with it. And the conversation always ends up going back to we've basically re-implemented MapReduce. So MapReduce is a way of doing like transforming, filtering, and aggregating collections of data, which works great when you have a bucket of data that you can run it against. And if you have a bunch of buckets of data, you can run MapReduce against a bunch of buckets. For example, like via a cron script or something. You can even kind of like map into smaller collections, like take your big bucket and slice it into smaller sub-buckets. But it does not always capture all of the use cases. Because like one thing we care a lot about in which is kind of common with mobile and web applications and common with IoT applications, is user or environment sessions are actually one of the core concepts that we end up having to deal with. And this is really challenging to reconstruct these sessions when sometimes they span between our time-based partitions or whatever partition we picked. And sometimes it's really hard to reconstruct them when the data comes out of order. So sequential batch runs are not always the best way. We end up with those broken sessions, which depending on the session length, that can either not be a huge deal, but depending on applications can actually be a bigger problem. So another way of dealing with these kinds of problems is doing kind of element-wise transformations as the data comes in. So data comes in and you pipe it down and you filter it down to something smaller. And that can kind of apply to elements as they flow past, which can help reduce the problem scope. But it kind of only goes part of the way to solving the problem. Another different way of approaching it is to have those time-based windows, the aggregation, but we end up with the same session slicing problem. So yeah, delayed data. Delayed data causes all those problems. Often what we want to do instead is reconstruct data based on when the event occurred instead of when it arrived. So we still usually want like fixed size output windows for doing kind of whatever aggregation is for most of the problem sets I end up encountering. But we want to be able to reconstruct that based on event time window. For example, we want to be able to reconstruct the session windows regardless of when the data came in. So we don't want to stream and break, have artificial breaks that happen. So let's talk about a specific use case that'll kind of ground this a little more. And I swear I wrote these slides before Pokemon Go came out. The kinds of problems we encounter in a lot of IoT sensor network type applications actually have very, very similar concepts to another use case, which is mobile gaming. So kind of a hypothetical use case that will kind of help put some constraints around the problem and add a little more clarity to the problem we're trying to tackle. So imagine a game that's focused on colored animals. It's a very popular game where players come in and do some mindless activity, like they poke the animal or something, Yeah, it's a really addictive game. It's also a team game. People organize themselves into different teams, like the green team, and the red team, and the purple team. And the teams are also kind of distributed all over the world. but they're not necessarily evenly distributed. For example, the Purple Monkey team, they have, for whatever reason, people in the continental US love that team, and they're all relatively closely geographically connected. Same with the Red Fox team. Almost all of them are in Western and Eastern Europe, so they're relatively close in time zone and geographic proximity. But other teams don't necessarily follow those lines and are kind of scattered around the planet. So what we want to be able to do is take the usage statistics of all these players and we want to aggregate them together to build leaderboards for that. So we want to be able to take the data from all these different players, combine them, and then reduce them down into a usable format that allows us to figure out which team is winning at any given time. Oh, and to make the game a little bit more difficult, the game also works while users are offline. So we want people to be able to play while they're disconnected and still be able to play the game. And then when they come back online, we want to be able to replay all the data they had and be able to aggregate that into the same leaderboards. And if data comes in much later, we want to fix those leaderboards after the fact. So problem scope. We have to deal with the fact that users have intermittent connectivity or maybe offline, you know, altogether for periods of time. We have inconsistent data delivery timing, which is a really ugly problem that we get to deal with. We have a large, endless stream of data because people play 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all across the globe. And we have multiple input and output streams. So we have different users, thousands and thousands of users all over the world playing simultaneously. But we also want to be able to draw a bunch of insights from all of their data that are kind of orthogonal to each other. And there are bursts of activity because we have events where people will come together and all play at the same time to achieve some goal. So activity will come in bursts, which can be expensive to scale to. Yeah, we want to be able to integrate and synchronize the data across all of those event streams. So whatever we come up with has to meet a few requirements. We have to be able to keep up with that stream of events, roughly. We need to be able to respond in real time. And for cost reasons, we want to be able to scale up to those big events where everyone's playing together. But we also want to be able to scale down so we don't have to pay for a bunch of computers that are sitting there idle. We also want to process data only once. So if somebody plays a game, does a mindless action in the game, we don't want to accidentally count that multiple times, which makes it a little bit more difficult in terms of approaching that computationally. And we also want to be able to accommodate those users who would go offline for days or hours or weeks at a time. And we also want to deal with anomalies, which come up a lot in Internet of Things use cases. But in games, it's always the same case. It's always people cheating. So we want to be able to detect cheaters and make sure we don't score them. So here's there's a lot of different ways to deal with this kind of problem set. But here's one that I've been using to deal with this and kind of similar sets of problems, which is we have data coming in. We put it into some kind of pub-sub system that helps us handle the bursts and the unreliable delivery situation. So we're using kind of pub-sub as kind of a shock absorber and a broker. And there's a lot of different pub-sub solutions out there in the world, but I'll be using the Google one because why not? Then we need to be able to, so we have a lot of data coming in. Pub-sub, which I'll go into more detail on in a moment, just kind of is a shock absorber, a queue for that data. But now we actually want to gather some insights from that. So we want to filter that data down. We want to be able to accommodate that late arriving data. We want to reshuffle that data. And for that, like pipeline processing systems are great. I'm using Dataflow. And then we actually want to be able to get insights out of it. So we want to take that intermediate data, like those leaderboards, and we want to dump them into something that we can actually get our hands dirty on, throw up a dashboard, see how the teams are doing against each other, run some SQL queries, something like that. And for that, we're going to be using BigQuery, which is cool. The cool thing about these things is they're all fully managed services, so you don't really have to deal with the scale stuff. Like, there's no servers, no real admin cost involved. And they all auto-scale up and down, which is cool. And there are open source alternatives to all this. So like lock-in, not as big a deal. So let's talk about the first stage of that in a little more detail, PubSub. So PubSub is kind of a general solution to a broad set of problems. It's a technology that's been around for a long time. And I've used it to solve lots of problems, like log events from servers. But it's actually really useful for this kind of use case where we have a bunch of data coming in from the outside world. So PubSub, this is one of my early hand-drawn diagrams. I apologize. But it was fun to draw, so you guys get to deal with it. So the idea behind PubSub is There's like a lot of messages coming in from all different kinds of sources. I have my little oil pump thing, or cell phones, mobile devices, or a random IoT thing, which is a gear with an antenna for some reason. You have a whole bunch of things with slightly different behaviors spewing data out. And the idea behind at least Cloud Pub Sub is each one of those will be pushing data into a topic. And then on the other side, you have devices that are consuming data from those topics via subscriptions. And you can have a many-to-one relationship of subscriptions and subscribers to topics. So this is really just kind of a last-in, last-out. It's just a queue. So PubSub in general is just a queue that can scale really wide. And the other thing that makes PubSub systems in general cool and useful for this kind of situation is they're cheap to operate because they're very efficient. So data goes in, data comes out. You can either push or pull data. Different PubSub implementations have different pros and cons. Like for example, I'm going to be talking about Cloud PubSub a little more, but there's a whole bunch of other systems out there. One I've seen a lot of people use, which is super popular now and super awesome, is called Kafka. It's open source. It has a slightly different feature set than Cloud PubSub, but it's a pretty close equivalent in terms of the capability. Because the whole market of PubSub systems kind of vary from less smart and faster and cheaper to run to more smart and more feature-rich and more difficult to maintain and slower. So Kafka and Cloud PubSub are on the less complicated, stupider, but faster and more efficient side. One of the big differences between them, which is one of the cool things about Cloud PubSub, is Cloud PubSub is globally available. So you insert a packet from anywhere in the world, and it'll go and magically end up in the queue. And it's not dependent on a data center. So if a data center disappears, it will keep working. So the API server is a little bit different, but these two are kind of similar in their level of complexity. So PubSub stuff in general, Kafka and Cloud PubSub allow for asynchronous messaging between different components, many relationships between the stuff coming in and going out. And they both have one interesting feature is they are not they support at least once message delivery, which means a message that gets pulled from the queue, if you have multiple subscribers, they may end up getting the same message more than once, which is a trade-off for efficiency and speed. But what you can do is you can deal with that in downstream so that you dedupe further down. REST and JSON API, you can also use an RPC API if you need a little bit more oomph out of it. Oh yeah, globally available, the cloud, the Google Cloud one, globally available, automatic scaling, replicated storage, all that stuff for the lazy like me. So what we're going to do is normally what I would love to do is bring a bunch of IoT devices and turn them on and spew a bunch of packets out and have them go in and show that happening. But that would make the Wi-Fi catch on fire, which would be sad. So I am going to mirror my displays. Yay, you can see stuff I'm showing now. Okay, so what I've done is I went over to the Google. So what I'm doing now is I'm simulating a big network of IoT devices, and I'm doing that with software, because why not? So what I've done is I spun up a VM ahead of time, because I didn't want to wait like 30 seconds for it to start up. It's not that big. It's actually only one vCPU. But even with one vCPU, I can simulate roughly 100,000 devices spewing something out, like a chirp per minute. So I wrote that all in Java. I won't subject you to it. So basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to run this incredibly nasty looking Maven command, which is going to fire up some stuff. It's going to authenticate with the stored credentials. And it's going to start injecting stuff into my PubSub queue. So I'm going to fire that up. And then we're going to see the Maven script run. And it's going to do its dance. And it's Maven, so it'll take a while to run. Because who here doesn't love Maven? I'm sure a lot of people here don't love Maven, but I have a love-hate relationship. But anyway, so it's going right now. And what this script does is it simulates thousands and thousands of users. It also simulates users sending erroneous data, like clicks that are impossibly fast on the silly game. It simulates a delayed delivery of data. So what it'll do every once in a while is it'll delay data for, in this case, this one's delaying for 312,000 seconds. So it simulates delayed data. It'll just start sending data out that occurred in the distant past. It also simulates bursts that happen from different teams. And it's just a big blob of like 200 lines of Java code. But we can see that it's actually working. So I can go over and take a look and see that it's queuing up events in PubSub. There we go. The little blue line's going up. So it's only done 91 requests so far. I think it's still coming up. The graph usually lags behind a little bit. So that's going to run for the next few minutes. And what's happening now is there's actually no one consuming from that pub sub topic right now. So if I go over to, it's going up a little more now. So if I go over to pub sub, I can see that nobody, this is actually pushing into the gaming queue right now. And there's actually no one subscribing, which is one of the cool things about pub sub is it's really good as a design architecture component. It's a very good way to deal with, you can actually bring the downstream systems down temporarily for doing things like maintenance work. And most pub sub systems will queue stuff up for a very long time. So like ours will queue it up for a month at a time, and Kafka is configurable, so you can sit there and spew the packets in while you munge around on the back end and roll your servers and all that stuff, which is cool. And I'm actually going to let it fill up that queue for a while. So I'm going to go back to the slides. Slides vanished. So I'm going to go back to the slides. Because presenter mode is challenging for Google Slides at times. So we're going to let PubSub sit there and queue up stuff while I wait for these slides to load. Talking about the use case, the recipe, the PubSub. Here we go. We'll start from here. And then we're going to talk a little bit about the next phase in that. So we're injecting a whole bunch of events, queuing up thousands and thousands and thousands. We're going to move on to the next stage. So Cloud Dataflow, which is a pipeline processing system. So the way Cloud Dataflow works is I have a whole bunch of data sources, and I can read them from, like, I don't know, log files I have somewhere, you know, data that I usually use MapReduce on. But I can also, what's cool about Dataflow is it uses the same code to do both real-time processing as batch processing. So this is a system we developed for doing like real-time behavior. So for example, like you watch a video on YouTube and we want to be able to update your recommended videos in real time, but we also want to be able to, if we have a new algorithm for recommending content, we might want to rerun it on all your historical data that we have so that we can come up with new recommendations. So this system uses the same code to run on old historical data in batch as real-time streaming data. And to accomplish that, what it does is it is opinionated about the way you write it. So it's both an execution environment as well as a set of libraries for building data pipeline processing stuff. So it's a little bit different than other systems like Spark, which is not as opinionated about how you use the data. So it's both the data storage and the software that runs on it. But the approach it takes to it is you have data sources coming out. These might be real-time data sources. This might be batch data. You build a pipeline out of steps. Each one of these steps is basically a map reduction or a shuffle. So whatever you do, if it is a task that you can break down into many small steps that you could do as part of a map or reduce or a shuffle, you bake into these and you use a set of libraries that do like parallel do is what we call it. So if you have a task that you can break down into an embarrassingly parallel task, it works really well to break down to these pipeline steps. And there's a whole bunch that we provide by default that you can use to build these, you know, out of composite. So you have the pipeline, you build a pipeline out of these different chunks, and then you dump them out to destination. Sometimes it's going to be like an operational database. Sometimes it's going to be like data files. In our case, we're going to dump it into BigQuery, because why not? And then you have a pipeline, and stuff works, which is cool. And there is a great open source alternative to this. So as I mentioned, the programming model and the execution environment are kind of coupled to allow it. But you can actually swap out the execution environment with a different implementation. So we have our own managed implementation. But there's also an open source one, which is Apache Beam. So you can take actually the same code with the same API and just run it on Beam, which is cool. You know, if you have a certain percent you want to run on your own metal, it works. Apache Beam is a young project, but it's pretty fun. So yeah, as I said, already mentioned, went ahead of myself. It's a unified model for streaming and batch analysis, which saves a lot of time writing software after the downstream. This is the stage where we can buffer enough information to process information only once through a combination of buffering it in the stages or just rerunning it when new data comes in. So this is how we flatten out those multiple messages coming in from PubSub if we use it as an input. It's a managed service, and like all managed services, it auto-scales, which is cool. It has built-in handling for session windows and late data. So some of the primitives that you can use to build those pipelines are specifically designed around late data and session windowing. And yeah, people use it a lot for real-time analytics and like the use case I said for recommendations, alerts, stuff like that. So it's really good at doing ETL, filtering, transformation, and extracting those insights that you can put into some downstream system, which is cool. So I'm going to fire up a pipeline now. Boop. And it's going to be another shell window into a different machine. Actually, I think it might be the same VM. But it's not actually doing any of the work. It's just setting up the job that's going to run on a different machine. So, and surprise, surprise, this is another giant Maven script because all this stuff is written in Java because Java's cool. So I'm going to run that. And what this is going to do is it's taking a job that I've already created and defined in a bunch of Java code. And it is submitting it over to the managed data flow processing thing, which we can then go see. Dataflow, we can go see appear on our list of Dataflow jobs. And we can see my old runs of the same job that are canceled now. While it's going, I'm going to go look at an old one. I accidentally left it running for a week once, my little simulator. And what's kind of cool is it only ended up using one of the ideas behind Dataflow is it can scale automatically to like 1,000 machines. But I ended up creating just under 1 billion events from my little test script, so 1 billion little user interactions. And it only used up, like it ran on, it never scaled beyond a single machine. So it's actually pretty efficient in that regard. How many nodes did I end up using? Oh, I ended up using, like, I think, team iteration. Oh yeah, it only ended up using, like it would have fit on one machine. I think it spun up 3 by default. But like the actual total execution time, I don't think any of the machines have more than like 15 hours of runtime. So it ended up being pretty efficient. So anyway, let's go see our queue that's actually running now. So we queued up a bunch of pub-sub traffic for a little while from our other handy-dandy script, which is still running, still pushing data, delayed data, garbage data, all that good stuff in. And then our pipeline is firing up now. It's been running for about a minute and hasn't really processed much data yet. But what we can see here is we can kind of break down. Oh, there it goes. Now it started. I can kind of give you an idea of the different things we'll be doing. So one, this thing does a couple different tasks. The game data comes in, we read it from PubSub, then I parse the game events, which are coming down as a JSON payload, and then I'm building 2 different leaderboards out of. I'm building a leaderboard for each team. This is too small. And I'm building a leaderboard for each user, so they can go in and see how they rank against their friends, as well as against their opposing teams. Each one of these has a different window for how much data I'm collecting at a time, and you can see how we end up building these out. Like as I mentioned, a lot of these end up correlating to a map. So if I break down one of these steps, like extracting the user score, I'm mapping them out. And then in this one, I'm just doing a sum of all of the user scores. And a sum is made up of a group and then a combine, which ends up containing a shuffle. And then finally, I write those scores over to BigQuery, which is broken down into converting it to a BigQuery and then writing it to BigQuery. So you end up breaking these down into very small chunks. Each one of these little boxes ends up correlating either to a library pull-in or a class we write. And it's catching up right now. So we'll let that run for a little bit longer while I move on to the next chunk of stuff. So while that runs and Dataflow is running, it's dumping it out into a place where we can play with that data called BigQuery. Let's talk a little bit about BigQuery after I do a time check. Cool. So BigQuery, open source alternative. This is one of like the straight implementations of the paper. It's called Apache Drill. And the idea behind BigQuery is a SQL interface to gobs and gobs and gobs of data. It is essentially a full table scan machine. So you put data into a columnar database, which is a very not very efficient at doing read and write. But if you have data that's written once and you just want to keep reading it, like logs from this game, events coming from a big IoT center network, or even web logs, which is what we originally built it for, it is very, very, very fast because it is a problem that is easy to split up across many, many, many machines. So BigQuery by default, it'll take a SQL query, break it down, and then by default it'll run it on about 5,000 end nodes at a time, which is great because renting 5,000 machines for 1 second costs the same as having, 5,000 machines for 1 second cost the same as having one machine for 5,000 seconds, but you get the answer much faster. And, spikes and stuff. Taking advantage of shared resources. So Yeah, so it scales relatively flat to petabytes of data. It uses a SQL dialect because nobody likes writing MapReduces. And this is actually why we built it, because it turns out our attorneys didn't like writing MapReduces. Only a few of them did. But a lot of them know SQL, which is kind of cool. Has a lot of SQL features, user-defined functions. Most people interact with it from a REST API, although there's a web UI I'm going to use for the demos. You can also take like a random ODBC dashboard and point it at BigQuery, and suddenly it'll work with like petabytes of data, which is cool. Just make sure you have caching on. The first terabyte each month, first terabyte of usage in terms of scans is free. And then after that, you pay like a nickel, I think it's a nickel terabyte? Yeah, it's like a nickel a terabyte. No, $5 a terabyte. So yeah, so this is an example of a query that it runs, which is basically in case my next demo doesn't work. In 36 seconds, we ran a query that processed a terabyte of data. What was that actually doing? I was looking through Wikipedia logs. Okay, so off-topic demo while I let that data flow thing run. Let's do some big data crunching so we can take a peek at what BigQuery does. So bigquery.cloud.google.com. And I'm going to turn that off so it doesn't show as much of my fancy stuff. Cool. Yeah, I had kind of the internal view briefly. So we're going to do some big data stuff. So has anyone ever done counted the words in Shakespeare as part of a tutorial before? No one? OK. So counting the words in Shakespeare is like the hello world of every big data application ever. It is the first thing you do, so I have to do it. So in 0.9 seconds, I processed 1 megabyte of data, and I counted that there are 164,000 distinct words that Shakespeare used in all of his plays, and many of which he invented himself, which is cool. But like, I could do that with like, you know, word count on the terminal. But unfortunately, to count to bigger things, I have to leave the world of classic literature, which is a bummer. But it's not that big a bummer, because there's really cool data sets available now that we live in the land of the web and the internet. One of my favorite data sets to play with is Wikipedia data, because Wikipedia shares a lot of their logs, which is awesome. So what this SQL query does is it goes through and it counts the total number of requests from the request logs for the first hour of February 12th, 2015. So if I run that query, it took about the same amount of time, took about 1.1 seconds, and it processed 46.7 megs of data. And it counted to 39 million. Like, okay, so we're getting a little bit bigger. We counted 39 million in 1 second. It took about the same amount of time as counting to 160,000. But you know what's cooler than a million? A billion. So we are going to look at a month, the entire month of May of Wikipedia data. And I think I have caching on still. Let me make sure that's off. I don't want it to cheat. So caching is off, just in case that data was cached. For whatever reason. Okay, so now in about the same amount of time, 1.9 seconds, we ran a query that processed 43 gigabytes of data. And it turns out that in a month, Wikipedia served, in 2015, about 21 billion requests. But you know what's cooler than a billion? A trillion. And what I could do is I've actually partitioned my data from Wikipedia into month-sized chunks, because that's what they give them to me in, and I didn't bother to recombine the files. But what I can do is I can run this thing called a table query to look. So what this does is it looks at all my data from 2015 that I bothered to download, which I think is almost all of it. Because Wikipedia only lets you download data so fast. Their pipe is just too small. So this one takes a little bit longer. We processed 460 gigabytes of data in about 6 seconds. So it's relatively flat. We got to not quite to a trillion, 254 billion. But you know what would be crazy? So I think crazy would be running a regular expression on each one of those rows. So this is the kind of query that makes a lot of other like big data systems sad. You can do this with MapReduce, but like a lot of SQL-like systems get sad. So what we're doing here is we're counting the sum of requests on all the data from 2015, and I'm running a regular expression on it on the title of each Wikipedia article. To see which ones, basically I'm counting requests on pages about dinosaurs, because dinosaurs are awesome. And I'm doing a case-insensitive match because I don't know what they're doing in terms of case sensitivity. I just want to make it a little nastier. So this time we counted the same number of rows, but we had to pull in a second column. We had to pull in the title column so we could run the regular expression. And we counted, so we ended up pulling in about 3.3 terabytes of data, and it still took about 20 seconds. So it ends up, the answer is 14.3 million requests in 2015 for pages about dinosaurs. So this is what you can do. This is the power of full scans and like lots of shared resources on the internet. Cloud computing is cool. And you could run the same thing, oh, demo time. And you could run the same thing on like your own, like you could use Apache Drill. The benefit of doing the same thing in the cloud is although they're functionally almost identical, the benefit of using a cloud provider, like a managed service to do that, like managed services in general, no matter who hosts them, is you get the advantage of resource sharing. So if there are 10,000 people all using that same pool of resources, we can each use all those resources for brief slices of time. Because honestly, to get the same kind of performance out of your own Apache Drill cluster, you're probably going to need about 5,000 spinning disks, which unless you have tons of usage, it's actually cheaper to use big data products from a cloud provider in many cases. And what's cool is like a lot of these things you can just point existing software to and it just starts working, which is cool. Okay, so this thing's been running for a while and it's actually been delivering data to BigQuery the whole time. So now that we've let it queue up a little bit of data, we can go to my leaderboard thing and we can run some queries against it. So yeah, this is boop. So what I've been pushing in there is I've been pushing in a couple different leaderboards. The first one is a user leaderboard where we push in the amount of time it took us to process the data, the total score the user has, and just like the user. So basically what we're getting is we're getting a whole bunch of snapshots of the user's rank against the other users over time. So we can query that table. And it's not terribly big, but a little bit unwieldy. So if we count it, we have about 189,000 rows of the leaderboard for the user leaderboard in there. And we can do things like, so what was in there? There was leaderboard user. We have the user. So count. So let's figure out which user has the highest score. Who is most addicted to our game? User. Max score. Select. Okay. From limit 1,000. Almost always, it's always a good idea to limit things. Group by. Let's see. Let's just do score. Trying to remember my SQL land. So score was not found. Oh no. Describe to me that table again. Number of rows, creation time. No, I want the schema. Total score. So we can see which one of our users is most addicted. We'll just look at the top 10. Boop. And we can see that Robot 4 is killing it in our game. There are snapshots over time, and we probably want the last slice too, because these are their score over time. So they've been, what this means is that for a number of different time segments, they've been the top user, at least for the top 10 different measurements we've made. We can do the same thing for the team. The team we have a little bit more detail on because it's a little smaller. We have window start, so we're doing different slices of it. We're also getting the total score over time for the team. So we can do something similar here, which is we can query against this table as well. So leaderboard team, query table. So we want to see the top team for the most recent window. Let's just find the top team of all time. So team, we want total score, window start. And the top 10 teams, I think there's like 20 or 30 teams in the game. And then we'll order. Order by total score desk. So we'll go look at them down, which is kind of fun. So it's fun to be able to. And it is Battleship Gray Emu is just beating Asparagus, other machine-generated machine name, and totally dominating Magenta Emu. So these are the kind of things that we can use to kind of, you can dump a SQL query like this. This is the kind of query that we can generate from one of those ODC dashboards like Redash or Tableau or something and just point it at BigQuery. and get really cool data from really cool data sets, giant, nasty, ugly data sets. So now that we've played around with the data a little bit in BigQuery, just kind of wrapping things up. So in the world of IoT, big data, it's a thing we have to deal with. It comes in different shapes and in different volumes than we are kind of used to from web scale. Because in the web, we ended up with data coming in a certain shape in a certain amount of time that tended to correlate with realistic users and the way they were interacting. The IoT, the fire hose, has many tinier pieces coming much faster from many different angles with different shape and different kind of delays and different things to deal with. So no matter what you're building, whether you're building a coffee pot to solve our coffee woes for the rest of our lives and make sure that we're always caffeinated, or who knows, the next crazy Kickstarter from those awesome boards you got from Adafruit or SparkFun, there's a lot of options out there for dealing with it, and it's important to think outside the box and even consider design patterns we may not have considered in the past. So thanks much for coming. One thing that's kind of fun about this particular one is I actually have a code lab that I've built around this also. So if you want to go see it in more detail, go ahead and hit the URL on my slide. And you can actually walk through the code and see all of that Java and all of its glory and the data and all of its shapeliness. So thanks a lot for coming. So are there any questions? Got it. So pubs.
Your requirement of only processing the data once.
Right. So the way we deal with it is the question was, how do you deal with PubSub not becoming a bottleneck or a point of failure or that kind of stuff? And it is kind of the universal entry point for a lot of the data. The way you deal with it not being a bottleneck is PubSub systems are usually the easiest thing to scale wide. So they do a very simple task, and they do it pretty well. So they can usually scale horizontally pretty well. You just add more instances, and it's going to be able to keep up with your data. And you're probably going to have fewer servers on that than anything. Like Spotify has a really good write-up on their old Kafka cluster. And that was for all the Spotify traffic. They had a relatively small cluster of, I don't remember what it was like 6 or 7 nodes. And that was able to handle millions and millions and millions of incoming queries per second. So that's one way, is you deal with that. They're also pretty good at reliably writing out logs that you can then spin up on another warm instance if you have to. So you end up with a little bit of a kludgy system if you're rolling your own, but it is worth the cost of trying to replace it with something else. It's just a design pattern that it's easy to scale fast.
Yeah, but your requirement was you can only process it once.
Oh, processing once. So the question was about the processing the data only once. So the way PubSub systems in general will not meet that, the way I deal with that is I deal with it downstream. So I solve it, the way I solve any problem is MapReduce. So whenever I see data more than once, I will take the most fresh copy of that data and then use that to trump the older copy of that data that I have. So the solution is essentially to rerun the job anytime new data comes in. So I use downstream systems to deal with that. I don't try and deal with that at the entry point because then I can get more reliability. Any other questions?
Dataflow, I'm a SQL guy.
Yeah.
So that's SSIS for me. And so, but with that being said, then Dataflow probably has you can do inputs like other REST services, I'm assuming, or other external things to pull data in from other places.
Yes.
And do whatever that stuff you need to do. I guess I'm just seeing this, and it's kind of cool because most of the stuff that I'm thinking I'd have to do right now would require spinning up hardware, which makes me sad. But for the most part, I could do everything that I would need to do.
Yeah, and actually the cool thing about the platform as a service stuff, which there's a whole bunch of different providers, almost everyone has a click to deploy Spark or Hadoop thing now, which if Dataflow doesn't quite strike a chord with you, if you're more comfortable with tools like Spark and Hadoop, you can go to a lot of these places and you can do turnkey, build me a Hadoop cluster from this stuff in storage buckets. And then run this MapReduce on it. And what I'm seeing a lot of people do is instead of having their own Hadoop cluster that they painfully continue to operate, we're at a point now where you can create a Hadoop cluster for a single MapReduce operation and then pull down the entire cluster, then create it again later when you have to run that same job later. And because you're only running the machine for 14 minutes or whatever, it ends up being saving a ton of money too. Or people who have their own infrastructure that they're running and that's really working well, we use it to handle, they'll have a second copy of the data out in a bucket somewhere, and they'll spin up another Spark cluster to deal with peaks in load. So when they have a peak, they'll use that to handle extra time.
Is using flat files a good way to kind of, so let's say I have a bunch of data, let's say in a SQL server or something like that, like just, you know, dumping all that out into CSV or getting that into some sort of storage account, like a bucket or whatever, that seems to be a good way to kind of move that data around. Because
yeah.
I guess that's the thing, you still have to get the data to something that can then do the work on it.
Yeah, you have to get the data somewhere. So the question was about like flat files and getting the data somewhere. So like a lot of people will use offsite. They'll use like Amazon S3 or Google Cloud Storage or something as like offsite backup for their logs and stuff, which happens to put them in a great place to do data processing when you need to. So if you have some running internally on your local cluster, you can use your backups there. And flat files are a great approach to a lot of this stuff because they are like the ultimate in portability. So no matter how things change, no matter what comes in style, like it seems like there's a new Spark framework every week. Like flat files, whether it be CSV or whatever, is fairly agreeable to your data. That's something that's going to be portable from system to system to the future, for the long term. So if you want to switch to something else in the future, you don't have to like map reduce all of your existing stuff to get it into a new format, which like you end up inevitably having to do, which is a pain. But deal with that later. Any other questions? Cool. Awesome. Well, thanks a lot for coming, and I'll be around for the rest of the conference. So if you have anything you want to talk about, come say hi to me. I love chatting about things, about the problems people face, and how you all have solved them. Because everyone comes up with really creative solutions to these kinds of problems when they run into them. So thanks a lot for coming, everyone.